Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard that he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him, when he had called together all the people's priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until they stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down to worship and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in the dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route.
Thank you. So the Christmas story. Sometimes when we read the Christmas story, we read it from the gospel account of Luke, and we hear about the shepherds. This is the account of the wise men visiting the Christ child. And it's a very intriguing story. When we tell a story, typically there are certain things that our minds key in on. I'm sure as you listen to it, there are certain questions that come to mind. And so this morning's message is going to key on the questions that we often want to ask when we study the scriptures. Have you ever wanted to know how to study the scriptures more deeply? Well, today I'm going to share with you some of the questions that you might bring to almost every text that you study when you look to God's Word. And we're going to examine this particular story of people from a faraway land that literally worshipped the stars. That when they saw a special star in the sky, recognized it, and traveled for months to worship someone that they didn't know. Someone that was just born. This story is filled with mystery, and it's filled with intrigue. And this story, unlike many Disney stories or fairy tales, is not meant to entertain us. It's meant to teach us something. Teach us something about Christ, teach us something about ourselves. And there's some real incredible life lessons in this story. I also brought an outline for you today because sometimes, if you're anything like me, we like to, as a family, go a little bit through the Christmas story with our families. You can keep this as a reference, maybe as a point of discussion at supper time or a devotional with your family, to share the light of Christ with them so that you have a little bit of an outline of this text, if you choose to read this particular one with your family. Now, why are the Magi called wise men? I'll start with that question. Why are the Magi called wise men? As I was thinking about this, wise men will stop and ask for directions. Seriously, though, when you study the scriptures on your own, you want to ask this question once in a while. Why? Or how did the Magi learn of this Hebrew Messiah that was to come? And the likely answer is this, that many, many years before this, about 500 years before this, the Jewish people were sent into exile into the kingdom of Babylon. And along with that group was a prophet, a Hebrew prophet named Daniel. And he wrote down prophecies. He, like the Magi of his day, interpreted dreams. That's what these people did. They interpreted dreams, they looked at the stars, they tried to foretell the future. So they were very interested in the stars, very interested in the future, and this was the thing that consumed their life. So it's very likely that they had possession of these prophecies, and when they saw the star, recognized it as a sign from above, and they put it together. And we're going to look at these prophecies a little bit later this morning. So that's maybe how they learned of it. We'll ask, well, what are magi? We call them wise men, but wise men really is not a very good description of who these people were. They're called wise men only because they were smart enough and wise enough to worship God coming into the world. So in retrospect, we call them wise men. But according to the scriptures, they're called magi. So what's a magi? Well, first of all, a little trivia question, yes or no? Are they Jews?
No,
they're not. So they are Gentile people. They're not descendants of Jacob. These are Gentile people. Do they believe in one God, or would they be considered pagans who believe in many gods? See, there are people who believe in many gods. So similar to the Greek astrology, you have all these different gods associated with the stars. These people would be similar to them. So they're Gentiles, they're astrologers, and they only have a partial set of information about this Messiah. That's why when they get to Jerusalem, they begin asking questions about him. So they have a partial knowledge, they travel a long way, and they're asking about the number of kings. Another question that's always good to ask when you study scripture is, what does this story tell us about God? I mean, the main characters in the story, it seems, are the magi that come from far away. It shows them in their travels, and then it gets to them when they get into Jerusalem and the dialogues they had with the people there. Then they go and they find Jesus in a house, not in a manger. They find him in a house. He's already a little bit older now. The star appeared when he was born. It took him some months to get there. And later we'll find out that Herod the king wants to kill every child that is under 2 years old. So it's been a little bit. Unlike our manger scenes and our Christmas cards, the wise men aren't lined up right behind the shepherds waiting for their turn to present gifts. It's a little bit different time frame in the timeline of the story. So, what does this story tell us about God? You can ask this about any text in the scriptures, because first, it's a word from God. Second, God is often present, even though he's not mentioned. Now, in this part of the story, the birth of Jesus, they come, Jesus is there. What does Jesus say to them? Nothing. He's just a baby. No proclamations, no "I'm God," none of that. So the role that Jesus takes in this story as an infant is rather minimal. But what about the other role that God has in this story? These magi were a long way from God, geographically. They were about 1,000 miles, by the way, from Jerusalem. But they were a long way from God. Sometimes we think that the closest people to God are the people in church. The Jews thought that the closest people to God were in Jerusalem. These were far from God. These were not church-going people. They weren't Jewish, they weren't temple worshipers, they weren't coming for celebrations, they didn't celebrate the holidays of the Jews. So modern day, these are people that wouldn't necessarily ascribe to Christmas or other religious holidays like we would be used to. So they were far from God geographically. They're also far from God racially. They were Gentiles. Sometimes we divide people by races and we think, well, God is less likely to speak to them than he is to us. They were also far from God religiously. Think about this for a second. Did God say anything to his people about worshiping the stars, fortune-telling, trying to predict the future? He forbade it, didn't he? He told his people that these are things that you don't do. Worship no other gods before me. In fact, there are strict rules against astrology, worshiping the stars, seeking the future. And these magi were all of that. What they they were not Jewish proselytes. They were magi, which is something like the combination of scientist, pagan god worshiper, astrologer, fortune teller. That's what these people were. And yet, when we sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing, don't we sing God and sinner reconciled? See, God revealed himself to these people far away, not only through his prophecies, but through his power. God will go to great lengths to seek out people that are far from him. So we shouldn't be quick to categorize people that we think should have known about God. In fact, the paradox in this story is the people that should know don't. And the people that we would categorize that would have no clue do. And God works this way sometimes. In Luke 19:10, it says that Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. Now, these people did something beyond that. They recognized some things, and then what they did is they sought him back. I want you to know today that God has sought you out. He seeks us out. Then once we realize he seeks us out, then we respond and say, do I seek him back? Do I search for him? Do I want to know him more? There's a reality about some people that are far from God. Some people that are far from God don't think that they are worthy to be accepted by God. They think because I've worshipped other gods, because I've had a sinful life, because of the things that I have done, that I don't deserve to be saved. But God's word is very clear in this. He came to seek and to save people who are lost. So, God's love is bigger than any obstacle between us. Has anybody ever been shocked when you found out that a certain person accepted Jesus as their Savior? Be honest. Yeah? When I was in youth ministry, I kind of expected the church kids to accept Jesus much more readily than kids that were on the field. Kids that would be invited to the youth group because we were doing some really cool thing. And they show up and they smell like smoke, they're addicted to drugs, they got spikes, and to tell you how old I was when I was in youth ministry, they had spiked hair and colors. It was back in the 80s. But after serving God for a while, I wasn't surprised anymore that God reached out and touched and saved people, because God reaches out for the stranger. He goes for the person that's on the outside, not the inside. Intentionally. In fact, the paradox is sometimes the people on the inside miss him completely. So he used an angel to get attention of the shepherds, and he used the star to bring the wise men. He uses miracles today. Amen. Mm-hmm. He uses his creation, people that see what he has made and they come to faith. And he uses his word and he uses his testimony, even some of our testimonies, to reveal himself. And who knows that this day he might even use his birthday to reach some of us. Wouldn't it be wonderful that if in the celebration of his birth, instead of just giving and receiving gifts and getting sentimental, that we might come to know him better? That's my prayer for all of us today. So, what about the other characters? What about let's examine the religious community here for a second. The group that we would expect to be waiting in line to come to the door of the house of the Savior that was born so that they might worship him. After all, had he not been prophesied to them people, the Jews? So let's take a look at them for a little bit. It says when they got into Jerusalem that it caused a stir. It disturbed the city. And it disturbed specifically the religious leaders, who are the teachers of the law and the priests. Modern day, this would be the professors in our seminaries and pastors. They're the ones that are caught not having a clue of what's going on, and it got them all riled up and upset. It's like, what's going on? Now, these people came to the religious capital of the world. It still is Jerusalem, What do we call that land where Jerusalem is?
Holy.
The Holy Land. Why? Because that's where God revealed himself. But God revealed himself in this place long before this. This is the place where the temple was built. This is the place was the central location of the Jews to worship God. The teachers of the law and the priests were the ones that regulated worship. They set up the worship services. They told people that came to the assemblies how to live for God, gave them all the rules, set all the routines. They set the liturgical calendar like we might have at Advent and Lent, which, you know, a lot of language that we create to have a Christian calendar year. Well, they had their Jewish calendar year. And the center of worship was in Jerusalem. But as I've said, frequently, religious people don't search for God because they think they already have him. They think they already have God figured out. And so they stop searching. They think, well, what do I have to search for? And then you say, well, why would the Jews in Jerusalem not listen to these men? Because their lives were very much regulated day in, day out, every day, from the time they woke up until the time they went to sleep. They had religious practices built in. They would tie God's word to their wrist and tie it onto their forehead because God's word said that it should be bound to your wrist. So they were very literally carrying out some of these things. They were carrying out their religious life to the letter of the law. And here's the key. The law was written by who? Men. They were following out the religious law written by men. You see, over time, the Jewish people gathered together and they collected these, what we would call biblical commentaries of what people interpreted God's word to be. They interpreted it to be a bunch of rules, and they interpreted it to be a bunch of regulations and how they did everything. So later, as we study Matthew together, as we study it all the way through Easter, we'll find Jesus saying things like, you have heard that it has been said that, but I tell you, and he does that over and over again. Why? Because you have heard that it has been said. He's referring to the Jewish oral law. They went way beyond what God had written. The Ten Commandments had 613 consonant letters in it in Hebrew. They made up a law for every single letter. They weren't content with the 10, you see. So their life was very, very regulated. You know, it's sort of like people making rules about what to do and what not to do on Sunday, like that one. It's easy to fall into this, you see. You dress a certain way, you sing a certain way, you go a certain way, you do a certain thing, you light candles in a certain order, and you celebrate things a certain way. And in the routines, in that process, they felt that that was knowing God. So who are these guys to tell them who God is? Because we've got to put it on the market of God. After all, our whole life is about God. What their whole life was about was rules and traditions and rituals, not what God actually said in his word, because they didn't know what his word even said. Now imagine, if God told you today that Jesus was going to come back, and he was going to come back in a certain city, and there are certain things, that events that are going to happen at that time, do you think that you would pay attention to what that was? I know I would think that I would want to. I would want to. But what did these religious leaders have to do when they asked the question? They had to go to the library and look it up. They had to go to the library and look up and find in the prophets, digging through those old dusty scrolls, what city it was that he was going to go, because they didn't know. These are the smartest people in the room. And they don't know where the Messiah is going to be born. Do you think the star just shone from where these guys came from? The star that got their attention that was different than any other star in the sky? That they followed for 1,000 miles? You think these people that lived there never noticed something new in the air? Well, hearts and the prophecies and the people that they were given to originally. So what keeps you from seeing God's word and keeping traditions of men? It starts with P, ends with E, and has an I in the middle.
Pride.
You think you know? Anybody like to be the smartest person in a conversation? Anybody here like to be right? I was talking with Amy the other night. We've been married a long time. And when we were talking about our relationship, we confessed to each other that we've gotten to the point now, after 28 years of marriage, where we're content only to be right 80% of the time. But you do the math on that. If each of us want to be right at least 80% of the time, that leaves a lot of room for error, doesn't it? We like to be right. And boy, do we like to be right about God. We like to be right about God. We like to have all the things laid out. This is what God thinks. This is the way that God has done it. I know everything about God. I know everything about me. And you're just trying to challenge that system. Well, challenge it, Jesus did. He challenged it like crazy. Now think about the traditions of men at Christmas. We give each other gifts. The tradition of the first Christmas, if you could call it a tradition because it was one of the first ones, was not to give gifts to each other, but was to give gifts to God. How is it possible that we might even forget to give a gift to God at Christmas? You see how traditions can mess a little bit with our religious practices? The greatest deception of all, listen to me in this, everyone, the greatest deception of all is to think that you know God when you don't. Because you feel comfortable there. And you stop seeking Him. Jesus, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 23, says, many will come to me and say, Lord, Lord. And I will say, away from me, you evildoer. I never knew you. That's religious people. So let's go back to the story. Let's look. The Magi show up. Herod and the religious leaders are stunned to find out that the Messiah has gone. They had no clue. And they're all troubled. Well, this is a little bit of a combination of the religious leaders. They were troubled because there's this group showing up that think they know about the coming of the Lord. These days, we call these groups of people Adventists. They're anticipating, and they're saying that they know something about the coming of the Lord. Ever hear of Seventh-day Adventists? There's a lot of Adventist movements, a lot of teachings concerning the return of Christ in the same way that there was then. So this Adventist group shows up, magicians from another country, woo, they're all this herd. Another thing here, sometimes we have our theology learned from Christmas cards and nativity plays instead of the scriptures. How many Magi were there, by the way? Great question. We say three because there's three gifts given, but it never says how many. I don't think three guys showing up in town would make a stir. There's a bunch. Many. How much would you have to pack to travel for 7 months? Right? Camels. Wealth. These wealthy people, they're carrying gold and stuff. They probably got some guards. Would you travel in that day with that much wealth without some guards? This is a group of people, probably armed, coming in, looking for a future king, and they're ready for it. And it causes a stir in town. Herod's all stirred up because we'll find out, we're going to look more at Herod this coming Lord's Day. He was a paranoid king. He always felt people were out to get him. And his desire was to murder this guy because it was a threat to his throne and his future livelihood. So, causes all a big stir. Well, what about the star? What about the scriptures? Did they know when Jesus, should they have known when Jesus was going to come? Now, the prophet Daniel, in chapter 9, verses 21 through 26, tells when the Messiah is going to die.
So if you extrapolate, when the Messiah is going to die, general time frame, when the Messiah is going to be born, because people only live so long, you might get a decent time frame of when the Messiah is going to come. In Daniel chapter 9, it says that there would be, at the issuing of the decree to rebuild Jerusalem, it would be 7 sevens and 62 sevens until the anointed one will be cut off. Okay, any middle schoolers here? I can ask you a very difficult math question. Ready? What's 7 times 7? 49. Okay, well, I'll help you out with the next one. 62 sevens, that's 434. Add 49 to 434, and you get 483. Now, their calendar was lunar. Ours is a little bit different, so we make the adjustment to our modern-day calendar, and it comes out to 476 years. Now, we know that's 476 years because in Nehemiah, he records when the decree to rebuild Jerusalem was, which was about 444. We call it B.C., but they didn't know that yet. Right? Remember when B.C. used to be before Christ? When A.D. used to be year of our Lord, now it's like common Christian year. I don't know, keep on changing. But this is the point. If you got lost in the math, anybody not a math major here? Okay. So, in essence, this is what Daniel said. In about 475 years from the time of the decree for Jerusalem to be rebuilt, the Messiah is going to die. He's going to be cut off. So that's the prophecy that came through Daniel. In my personal opinion, the Jews didn't even care. They didn't know about it. And before we get too judgmental about the Jews and prophecy, are you a student of prophecy of the Lord's second return? Does Daniel speak to that too? It's very, very easy to listen to the traditions of men and believe in what they say instead of studying the scriptures ourselves. And this is the problem. It's breathtaking. It's stunning that approximately 500 years before Christ was born, that these people from a different religion paid so close attention to this prophecy, because that's what they were interested in. You know anybody that's interested in prophecy? Anybody know anybody that's interested in prophecy? Some people are very interested. They've got a lot of books about it. They studied it. Like me. I really love prophecy. But what about the star? Numbers chapter 24, there's a reference that says this. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. Now, when was Numbers written? Oh, maybe 700 years before Daniel. So these people that are interested in looking for the future collect prophecies and they study them so that when something happens, they recognize it. And by the way, friends, this is how you recognize fulfilled prophecy. Prophecy is not given so that we can become predictors of it, because prophecy itself is the predictor. Prophecy is given so that when something happens, we recognize it. And the Jews of that day did not. And because of that, we can conclude very easily that they didn't care. They didn't pay attention. Because they had their religion. They knew all they needed to know. Maybe they thought that it would just be so obvious everybody would realize it. And looking back in history, we see it. We think, how more obvious can you be? But they missed it completely. Because they fashioned their own teachings and traditions and practices instead of the Word of God. They didn't know the Scriptures. It's been a little subtle, but I'm encouraging all of us to know the Scriptures. It's one of the reasons that our church is named Grace Bible Fellowship. We need to be centered in the Word at all times. Now I want to ask yourself another question. Sometimes when you're studying Scripture, it helps to put yourself in that place and ask yourself a question. Say, now, we're the religious community. People driving by, if they were to see us gathering, they'd see, you know, a preacher and people listening, they might think that this is a church, right? So we might be considered to others outside of this, the religious community. So we're the religious community. as are other churches, that buildings that have steeples and preachers and such. Some of them even have the name church in them, so it's real easy to identify. If a practitioner of witchcraft walked into an assembly and told them that Jesus was in their midst, what would they think? What would we think? We think you're nuts. We're the ones that know about Jesus, you see. So the warning here is that we have to be careful about all of our preconceived notions about God, because we can learn things from other people and traditions that are not in line with God's word, and we can get off track, way, way off track as religious people. Now, the Magi didn't say this word for word. They didn't come in and say, Jesus, the Messiah, is in your midst, and you should know about this. They just asked a simple question. But a discerning person would realize that, right? So, how come they didn't see it? Because of their pride. They couldn't see it. Now, I want to get to another question when we study Scripture. This is one that we often forget. What isn't in the story? You ever watch a movie and you have a big question mark at the end? Like, what about that and this? What's with that character? Some strange thing, some similar. What did that mean? When we study Scripture, sometimes it's helpful to look at what's not there. And it's glaring fact that in this story there's no record of a single person from the religious establishment of Jerusalem that goes. None. Shepherds in the flock, watching their flocks by night, we sing about that, right? They go and they worship the child with singing and praises. And we've got these magi from a different country that come up. We're the priests. We're the people that should know better. Nowhere to be seen. After all, what would a Gentile heathen astrologist possibly know about their Messiah? So here's the truth for today. We can have familiarity with the Bible. We can have religious convictions. We can have religious practices. We can even live out some of God's commands and not know God. But Jesus said, "Seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened." Have you legitimately ever searched for God? Not followed the practices of your parents and grandparents, not going through the routine of, you know, it's good to go to church on Christmas, or, you know, it makes grandma happy to do it for other people. In your heart, have you ever sought to find God yourself? Hebrews 11:16 says, "Without faith it is impossible to please God." You can go through rituals, you can do things, you can give offerings, you can go into the temple and you can do prayers and have people pray for you. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. That's Hebrews 11:16. So, before we go further, I want to give you this challenge. Sometimes Christmas season can be a little busy. Amen? Take some time to reflect and ask yourself this question about your own religious life. You might not have taken the time. I don't want to judge you in that. I want you to judge yourself in this. I want you to reflect on your religious situation. Because, frankly, I don't want any of us present here to make the same mistake that the Jews did back then. When we come to church, or when we try to live good lives, are we doing this to seek Christ and draw closer to him, or are there other reasons? Because we know, religion can take on a life of its own without God in it at all. It's easy to identify another religion. We look at Islam and we think, well, they proclaim it's a religion of peace and yet they're killing people all the time. This doesn't make any sense. Well, it doesn't make any sense for a Christian who believes that Jesus is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We go to whatever we want and never worship him either. But how many Christians do that? It doesn't make any sense to say, I believe that in the authority of the scriptures there's a rule and a guide for everything in life and never read it either. Does it? So it's important for us to reflect. Can you think of anything more worthless than going to church and not finding God? Yet it happens all the time. Can you imagine working out with no physical benefit? Here's a little leisure. Can you imagine a student going to school without learning? A soldier going to war without knowing what they're fighting for? Having a pet turtle? That was supposed to be funny. I haven't tested that one on my kids. I tried out another one, having a pet cat. Anyway, if you're a cat person, sorry. Yet this happens all the time. I know from some of your personal testimonies that you've shared in our own fellowship here that this is your story. You went to church, grew up in it, was given the information, and never did God. See, their story in a lot of ways is ours. We just don't realize it. I taught on the Lord's Supper here a few weeks ago. Many of us have taken the Lord's Supper many, many times without receiving teaching on it. And someone shared with me afterwards that the first time that they participated in it, they were given a wafer and they didn't know what to do with it, so they put it in their pocket. And then they went to the wedding reception afterwards and he still had this wafer in his pocket. So he pulled it and said, what am I supposed to do with this? And somebody told him that he was supposed to use it for the free space of a bingo card. So when they played bingo a little later, he put it on the free space and someone totally wigged out. It's like, the pocket of Christ is a free space. But we can do a lot of things without even knowing what we're doing, can't we? It's not so hard for us to understand. Missing the point. So, let's take time to reflect and ask ourselves, am I seeking God? I want us to learn one more thing. This is the last thing that we're going to learn from the Magi today. Okay? So you can check that off if your time clock for your roast is going. What did they do when they came to Jesus, when they found him? What did they do? Anyone? They worship. The root word of worship is worthiness. God is worth it. He's worthy. Holy is the Lamb. Holy, holy, holy. Worthy is the Lamb. The root word for worship is worthy. We give him adoration. And the shepherds, on coming to the house, saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and they worshiped him. So I want to refresh our minds with the three things of worship. One, they bowed down. How many of you instinctively, when someone says, let us pray, do this? Anyone? Bow your heads? Instinct, right? In fact, I've kind of observed that sometimes when you're sitting in a group of people and you begin to pray, a lot of people, when you say, let us pray, they slide forward in their chair, they bend their shoulders, and they kind of sit forward too. It's just like a physical reflex. What does it mean? Well, bowing down communicates submission to the other person's authority. That's why so many people were upset when President Obama bowed down before leaders in other countries. It's not an equal bow, it's a submission of yourself before that person as an authority above yourself that got people all wigged out. It communicates submission, that the other person has authority over them. And this is why we say that when we believe in Jesus, that we call him Lord. We submit to his authority over our life and we call him Lord. That's why we bow our heads in prayer as an act of submission. Our posture before God shows our humbleness before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And if you haven't gotten on your knees very much lately, that's how they likely bowed down. They probably didn't do a courteous bow like this. They probably got on their knees and offered their gifts. It's amazing how body posture can change our attitude itself. And they also worshiped another way. They presented the gifts, and we know them. There's a lot of teaching on them. They gave an offering. Worship always offers something. Offering up prayer, offering up praise, offering up service with your hands, offering up resources that you possess. Worship always offers something. The gifts that they brought were very valuable. Not especially practical, except gold. Who wouldn't think gold is practical? It's symbolic of the king, kingship, gold. But it also had some financial input, you know, impact on them. So God likely provided for them the ability to travel to Egypt and back and to live without having the means because they were poor. How do we know they were poor? Because when they presented Jesus in the temple, they offered up doves as a sacrifice instead of a lamb. So they're poor. So they've got some resources. And then they also have frankincense. And what's the last one?
Myrrh.
We know that from the songs too, right? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Frankincense was something. Take off frank. What is it?
Incense.
Okay, so incense was burned to symbolically offer up prayers to God. And this is what was lit in the temple. The key thing about it, though, it could only be lit by a priest. So this is recognizing Jesus as prophet, priest, and king in these gifts. So they're recognizing who he is, and they're giving them to him. And the third gift was myrrh. Myrrh was an ointment that was used to embalm dead bodies. Remember the prophecy said that he could be struck down? This was likely the same exact myrrh that the women used to anoint his body after he was dead. This gift that was given to Jesus was carried along by his mother all that time so that it could be applied to his body after his death. Which points to the very purpose of Jesus dying for our sins. At Christmas, we put great effort into giving gifts to each other. We have to remember what we're giving to God too. And lastly, after they met Jesus, this is key. Some of you met Jesus a long time ago. Some of you are just meeting him now. Your journey doesn't end there. After they present the gifts of Jesus, the angel appears in a dream and says, "Hey, don't go back to the Herod and tell him the report that he asked." So they go a different route. They probably went the south route around the sea. But instead of the north, they took a different way, is the point. And after we meet Jesus, it doesn't mean God's going to stop talking to you or revealing himself to you. Our search doesn't end when we meet Jesus. We remain submitted to his will, and we listen to what he has to say. And we become obedient to it, just like they were. So, just because we've sought God and found him doesn't mean that we're at end. And I just want to speak candidly about this, because as a pastor and someone that's lived in this life a long time in the church and with a lot of Christian friends, I see a lot of people who meet Jesus and remain utterly unchanged. Don't really care about worshiping him anymore. Worshiping God is kind of a low priority in their life. Other things fill their schedules. Reading his word, listening to what he has to say, low priority. Entertainment is much more valuable to them. Have never read the scriptures, but they got a DVD collection of about 300. Lots of music. Priorities everywhere, but God is pretty low on the list. Worship requires continued listening and seeking of God. And the Magi teach us this. So, what
is your place before God in respect to Jesus, your King? Are you far from him? I want you to know that Jesus not just would go to the ends of the world to save you, he did. He gave up the glory of heaven for it. Allow himself to become a baby and have somebody change his diapers and not be able to control his bowels. That's God. Giving up the glory of heaven to be an infant. And then finally going to the cross. If you think that you are a lost cause, if you think you're too far away, you think that you've done something so bad, you're sorely mistaken. I've got some good news for you. That's why I call it gospel good news. Jesus came to reintroduce himself to you so that you could be saved and know him as Lord. Are you a worshiper of Christ? What are you offering him? I'll tell you what he doesn't want the most. He doesn't want the most is your money. So a lot of people can give money relatively easily. We can give God our money, we can give God our time, we can give God ourselves, our whole selves. When we make him Lord, that's what happens. And lastly, are you opening up to God's continued leading in your life, or have you just kind of put it on cruise? Thinking, well, I know all I need to know, I'm doing all I need to do, and I'm pretty comfortable. When you're in that mode, you're very unlikely to see what God is trying to reveal to you. And you eventually can be misled. Sometimes through going through the motions of the religious life, especially times like Christmas, where you've got a lot of family routines that intersect with a holy day. Good holiday, just in case you didn't know, young people. Didn't know that? Holiday, holy day, Jesus' birth. Just calling you out there, you know. Sometimes we think holidays are just a day that you don't have to go to school or something. So we can make a holy day completely secular. It's very easy to miss Jesus as our Savior and worship him. Please show me a word of prayer. God, it's amazing how much we can learn when we study your word. It's amazing how much we can learn when we watch how other people have come to you. Thank you for the magicians that lived in Babylon all those years ago so they could teach us some lessons today. Thank you for revealing yourself to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to serve him as Lord and to listen to him and be obedient to him all of our days. In the precious name of Jesus, our Savior.